So you do not think that the desire to nurture a child, as opposed to gain one's identity from being the head of sales at a department store, is built in?
No.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Dennis Prager Show. Mentioned the latter part because my guest is from England and is speaking in London right now. She is English herself, Laura Bates. She is the creator of the Everyday Sexism Project, and she has a book titled Everyday Sexism, where she fights sexism. She writes regularly for The Guardian, The Independent, The New Statesman, Time Magazine, given TED Talks, spoken at universities, contributor at Women Under Siege, a New York-based organization working to combat sexism and so on. And I first of all, welcome Laura Bates to to the Dennis Prager Radio Show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
You're very welcome. We may not agree, but I just want you to know in advance I am very polite.
Oh, great. Me
okay.
Too.
All right. Very good. Excellent. So I've read good chunks of your work, Everyday Sexism, your project. I'm going to ask you, and it's an honest question. Since there's everyday sexism, and it sort of puts you on the spot, but it's not intended to. I just want to know: do you mean that literally? For example, yesterday, did you experience sexism?
Yes, so I mean it really to have a double meaning. And when I started the website, I meant it to have a double meaning. So firstly, it was to suggest that these are issues that are happening on a daily basis, that women around the world are being affected by sexism on a daily basis. But I also wanted to try and get across the fact that some of the things that are even more serious forms of abuse, things like rape and domestic violence, are also happening every day. And that we need to also tackle the kind of everyday things that have become so normalized that they're considered widely acceptable, the kind of public-facing types of sexism that we would kind of mostly consider societally normal, that there's an everyday element to sexism because it's become very acceptable.
All right. So, well, then you don't really mean that women experience sexism every day, but that every day there is an expression of sexism. Is that what you're saying?
Well, I think there are many women who experience sexism on a regular basis. I'm not claiming that every single woman experiences sexism every single day, although it's funny that you should ask, because actually I did experience a group of men shouting at me in the street yesterday.
What did they shout?
They were shouting comments about my breasts.
Uh-huh. And by the way, just out of curiosity, I am just truly curious, were they Brits? Were they...
Yes, this is in London.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
So, you know, I think it is something that women face on a regular basis, let's say. And I think certainly it's something that women and girls experience more often than a lot of people are aware of. I think it's a relatively underreported problem.
I have had some black callers over the course of my career call in and tell me how there is daily racism.
Yes.
Right. And so I asked them the question. So I said, well, since there's you believe that you experience it every day, could you tell me the racist experience that you had today?
Mm-hmm.
And invariably they go, well, you know, the day is young, so I don't know yet. All right, so yesterday. Well, you know, not really. Well, in the last week. So
right.
my assumption is that in the Western world, or at least in Western Europe and the United States and Canada, let's put it that way, I think that mm-hmm. there is a lot more sexism and in a far more dangerous way in other parts of the world. But in the United States, Western Europe and Canada, it would seem to me that it is probably better to be a woman than ever in the history of being a female. And secondly, it is better to be a female than to be a male, because in every area, from suicide to failure to graduate high school, women have much better statistics than men.
Okay, well, I think what I'd say is that first of all, you know, to refer back to your comment about things happening on a daily basis, I think people shouldn't have to prove that they've experienced a form of prejudice, whether it's sexism, racism, or anything else, every single day in order for it to be valid. And
right, but only, forgive me, I don't want to, I'm only interrupting because I want to just react to that before you move on.
Okay.
The claim, though, I'm only reacting to the claim that one experiences racism or sexism every day. I agree with you. It doesn't have to be every day for it to be a problem.
Okay. I think in a way you could also argue that women and that other minorities or people are experiencing prejudice on a daily basis in a structural way. So, for example, a woman might not experience harassment every day, but she still experiences the pay gap every day when she goes to work, for example, and earns only 79 cents for every dollar that a male peer earns, for example. So I think that there is that argument. But to refer to your point about the Western world, this is a really interesting thing. I think, yes, of course, it's true that we've made great advances, and that's fantastic. You know, I would celebrate those advances. I'm not claiming that women don't have the right to vote or face other injustices that they have done in the past. But I also, while I celebrate that progress, I don't think that that's a good enough excuse to say that women shouldn't be allowed to speak out about the injustices that they are still facing. And, you know, if you want to talk about statistics, if you want to say, you know, that women have never had it so good and that they have it better than men, you've got to look at statistics around sexual violence. You've got to look at the fact that one in five women experiences a rape or attempted rape in her lifetime in the U.S. You've got to look at the fact that in the United States, three women a day on average are killed by a current or former partner. So, you know, I don't think it's fair to say that these issues aren't happening. And actually, the most serious abuses are happening even on our own doorstep. I think it is a common and understandable thing to want to say, look elsewhere, look at what women are dealing with elsewhere. But actually, I think it's a red herring. Although, of course, we care about what women are facing everywhere in the world. It's also valid to discuss the sexual violence and the sexism and the discrimination that women are facing in the United States or the United Kingdom as well.
All right, so let me read to you some data, then I'll react to some of the data that you provided, all right? This is from a person who would be described in American terms as liberal. It's a New York Times columnist. What is Leonhardt's first name? David Leonhardt. Leonhardt. He actually is an editor of a section in the New York Times. By eighth grade, 48% of girls receive a mix of A's and B's or better. Only 31% of boys do. In light of this, it's no surprise that women make up 57% of college students, 67% of college graduates, and 70% of university valedictorians. Now, in light of that, if the data were the opposite, people would be crying sexism. Given these data, why isn't it worse to be a male in modern America?
Well, I think you're absolutely right to highlight the fact that there are certain issues where men are experiencing problems. What I don't understand is the need to set these up as if they're kind of conflicting issues, as if it's a battle of the sexes. I think that there are massive issues affecting women structurally, systemically, in terms of sexualized violence, for example, in terms of inequality, in terms of reproductive justice, and so on. And yes, there are also certain issues that are particularly impacting on men. What's interesting to me is to see these as connected. So I don't see it as a kind of competition for who has it worse. The way I see it, I think certain outdated gender stereotypes are having a negative impact on both men and women. So, for example, you earlier mentioned the male suicide rate, which you're absolutely right, is higher than the female suicide rate. Now, to me, I don't see that as something kind of contradictory, as a sort of, oh, well, then we can't talk about the problems affecting women. I see this as being men and women both suffering from the same outdated idea, because really, I think a major part of the reason why men don't feel able to reach out and get the help that they need to deal with mental health issues when they face them is because of the societal stereotype that men have to be strong, that boys don't cry, that it's not okay for men to talk about their feelings, that that's wimpy or sissy. And of course, the flip side of that is the stereotype that women are hysterical or emotional or hormonal. You know, so I think that...
That's the suicide issue. Why are so many more women graduating college than men?
I don't know. I think that's a really interesting question, but I don't think it logically follows to say therefore women are winning, because we do know that even immediately after they graduate college, a survey by the AAUW, the American Association of University Women, has found that even at that point in their lives, even if more of them are graduating college than men, they are also earning a lot less than their men.
Yeah, all right, just for the record, I do not believe that statistic. I know you do. So there's no meeting on that. It has been so well debunked by sociologists and others. I always fear when it's made again. But we're going to continue. Laura Bates, on that pay issue, which I didn't let you respond because we had to take a break for, we have commercials in the United States on our radio shows.
Sure.
Which gives us the great advantage of all sorts of diverse opinions on American radio, much more so than in Europe. In any event, this 73 cents or 79 cents to a dollar. So I have just a quick, because I know we could spend the hour debating this, and I don't want to. We differ, and that's fine. I just want to ask you just a logical question. If I'm an employer, and I would get the exact same work from a person for 79 cents that I would get from another person for a dollar, why would I ever hire the dollar person?
Well, I don't think that that is exactly how the gender pay gap works, thankfully. I don't think that employers are always deliberately going out and employing women at 79 cents and men at a dollar. I think it's rather more complex than that. But I think that if you're asking, should we perpetuate inequality for personal gain, then no, my opinion would be that we shouldn't do that. And that actually, you know, if we're empowering women and paying them as much as men are being paid, as much as they deserve to be paid, then we are also empowering their families and their children. And we're
so then, wait, forgive me then. How does it work? There were two people coming to be employed at my place. And if you say it's more complex than that, but that's...
It is.
That, well, I often find, though, that that's somewhat of a cover-up for... I really don't have an answer, and I'm not saying this about you, but when I went to graduate school, I learned that complex was often exactly that, a cover-up for, I really don't have an answer. If an employer can employ somebody at 20% less... Why would they not employ only those people?
Well, because it would be the wrong thing to do.
Wait, so employers then are moral? I don't get it. If they're moral, then they would give women this.
What is happening here clearly is not that employers are directly hiring men and women and in the vast majority of cases choosing to give women lower starting salaries than men. I think that that does happen in some cases. But I think that what we're seeing here is far more complex. So, for example, let me make it clear what I mean by saying the word complex. For example, we know that women are concentrated in particular industries which are valued less than industries which men are more likely to dominate in. We know that when women move into male-dominated industries, the pay in those industries tends to drop. And conversely, that when men move into female-dominated industries, that the pay tends to rise and those industries tend to become more respected. We know, for example, that often there is a subconscious bias, which means that women might be considered a maternity risk or less likely to be considered for promotion, for example. You know, there are a huge number of things that have an impact here. So it isn't as simple a case as just saying,
right, okay.
Oh, an employer looks...
So then I'll give you a real-life example of why that might... Why some of the things you mentioned might in fact happen.
Okay.
In medicine, women are far more likely, I'm speaking only for America, I can't speak for the UK, graduates of medical schools in the United States, women are far more likely to go into four specialties: radiology, ophthalmology, anesthesiology, and dermatology. The reason is that overwhelmingly they have fixed hours. They can work as many hours as they like. They don't want to work that many hours, whereas men do want to work more hours. That's a sociological, psychological fact. Men are more career-driven. I know this may drive you nuts, but unless you believe that men and women are truly identical, then it does make sense.
I don't think it's possible for us to say, I mean... You say that we could argue about the pay gap for the rest of our time. We could certainly argue about nurture versus nature for the rest of our time. I don't think it's possible to separate one from the other unless we were to live in an equal society. We live in a society where we give children dolls if they're girls and chemistry sets if they're boys. pink for girls, blue for boys, superheroes for boys, princesses for girls. We send a huge number of messages to young people from an early age about what we expect of them. So I think that it's not possible in the society we live in to say it's something about the male brain that wants to work longer hours. I think we socialize men and women into thinking that those are the roles that they should play. And anybody that does want to play those roles, that's absolutely great. This is not about sort of any kind of imposed, forced, precise, equal split. But we do live in a world in which when people have children, for example, that is something that benefits both men and women. Both men and women choose to have children. In most cases, when a child is born, there is a man and a woman involved. But it is women who disproportionately pay the price for that in terms of the impact on their careers, in terms of the impact on their career progression. And I'd suggest that that's a societal issue that we haven't dealt with very well, rather than something inherently biological.
Right. Okay. So as you wouldn't know, but one of the mottos of my program is I prefer clarity to agreement. So if I may just state, this is the clear area where we disagree. You okay. do believe that men and women are essentially the same and all differences are the result of socialization.
I think it's not possible for us to make the distinction or the assumption either way, but I think the majority of differences are likely the result of socialization.
You do not think that the desire to nurture a child, as opposed to gain one's identity from being the head of sales at a department store, is built in?
No, and I think that's really insulting to the majority of men as well. I think that the desire to nurture and love a child is inherent in many of us, in parents.
No, to have a child is one thing. To nurture the child on a more full-time basis, I think that that, in fact, is usually sex-based and biologically rooted. So I,
okay,
as I
so
say,
in
I
that
just,
case, you're yeah. right. We agree to disagree.
Okay. All right. That's fair. But so when women say, you know what, I do get more satisfaction from being with my children than I do from being the head of sales at a department store, you are in your heart, you're thinking, oh, is that sad? This woman has just been so socialized.
No, I think for many women that would be true. But I would argue that for many men that would also be true.
Well, how come there are almost no men who choose that?
Because we live in a world that teaches men and women that these very stereotyped gender roles are what is expected of them.
Okay. All right. Well, listen, I really deeply appreciate your time with me. I hope it wasn't traumatic.
Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome.